Assalamu alaikum, everybody.
Wa alaikum salam.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. My name is Islam. Let me introduce myself. My name is Islam. The root word of peace, salam, or even salima, meaning submission, which to a Muslim is like tuition. It's his ticket in. Before I begin, let me greet you like I'm supposed to do. So, assalamu alaikum. May peace be unto you. You know it's kind of funny. I'm accused of oppressing while really I am oppressed. I've been on a list of things to detest. I'm screaming and rage in almost every protest. And I've been red scare, a threat to the West. You see, if you look at me and all my obligations, you'll see why I have such a great population. It's cause there is that motivation and that sense of inspiration that keeps Muslim as their occupation. To me, being a good Muslim means being a good person, because I'll never ask you to kill or to slay or to lie at least 5 times a day. I'll never ask you to steal or to hate or to swear or to discriminate. I'll actually tell you to smile to everyone you see, because a smile is the best form of charity. I'll tell you not to smoke and not to drink, to stay clean and take showers so you simply don't stink. I'll tell you to care for animals and treat them with care. So yes, I'm against animal testing and abuse in case you weren't aware. I'll tell you to treat those who treat you better, better. I'll tell you not to be mad at someone for more than 3 days. I'll tell you to respect women and lower your gaze. I'll tell you that paradise lies under the feet of your mothers. I'll tell you to passionately love your significant other. I'll tell you to never mistreat your wife. I mean, if I tell you to care for animals, then what about the love of your life? I'll tell you to be precious and save yourself for the one, so you don't keep giving yourself away till you're literally done. I'll tell you to be moderate and that balance is key. Just in the middle is the perfect place to be. I'll tell you to excel in all that you do, from that essay to that slam dunk too. I'll tell you to clear your ignorance and to never judge. To love for your bro what you love for yourself. And to never hold a grudge. I tell you to be a good person, a person of peace and a person of love. And they say I'm a terrorist, an extremist. And you know what? I am a terrorist. I terrorize terror. I kill injustice to make the world fairer. I am an extremist. I am extremely kind. So beware of my extreme benevolence to all of mankind. And yes, there are those who kill and bomb in my name. But if I don't approve, then why am I to be blamed? In every religion, you will find those who abuse it, thinking that they have a permit to do wrong. A religion may be perfect, but the followers may not be. So when mine commit mistakes, don't blame it on me.
I give what I got, and what I got is good. So if they do otherwise, they misunderstood. And I'm not here to preach, I'm only here to teach. I'm a professor in politics, economy, and sociology. In manners and etiquette, I got my PhD. To all my teachings, I have 2 sources. The Book of God and the Words of the Prophet are my resources. I teach for free, and whoever desires to learn, I'll add, it's all for the sake of Allah. I ask for nothing in return. And listen, I'm not here to convert, but just to clear misconceptions with the way I'm viewed and my common perception. Because yes, it hurts when I'm literally abused by some who do it for pleasure just to be amused, and by some who just follow the trend because they're clearly confused. In a nutshell, my name is Islam.
Yeah, no problem. Well done, mashallah.
Beautiful.
I just want to say this, that one of the problems I think, or this is my belief, that we have is honoring our own. You know, we find it difficult to honor our own. But I was saying to Brother Sahidem earlier, since growing up, I used to be very angry because, you know, you're living in a house and my grandparents, them, they always had all the best wares packed away in the cabinets. I think we practice the same thing sometimes, you know. And you don't get to use it. You're there every day. You're using the cup that probably the handle break or some plate that got a little crack. You know, but when your family come from overseas, that ain't even sending a little money to help you and the children or even giving you a phone call when they come and they come to visit, we give them the best. We give them the best. We go in the cabinet, we take all the best, all the fancy, you know, utensils and so on, and we have them eat with it and so on. And when it's finished, you tell the children, listen, don't break the thing, you know, wash it properly, put it back up. And you're there every day with the family, and we don't on our own. You know, we can't go up to a sister and say, well done. You know, and because what? It is not me. You know, we're so selfish. We want everything, you know. If somebody comes up with an idea, oh, they're not gonna work. No, don't worry the thing. My brother thing will work. Next thing you know, the person is the same thing, you know. You know why they want that praise and they can't honor a brother or sister. So they fight you down and then they try to give birth to your baby and the thing doesn't even come off properly because they don't know what you were thinking. Because you had that dream or you had that vision. No one else can bring your vision to fruition because they don't know. But they will try because they want to be recognized. So I want us to understand one of the things that we have to start doing is honoring our own. We need to start among ourselves. Say to the brother, say to the sister, well done. There's nothing wrong with doing that. Give praises where it's due. Okay? This is my belief. We'll now move on and we're going to have a presentation. This is going to be done by Sister Fazia. And she's going to talk about the hijab, better known as we know it here, the kimar. And I know for most of the young ladies here and women in our midst who don't wear kimar, for us it has been, you know, challenging. Some of us, I know, would like to, but because we're still living with our parents and we're not allowed to make that decision, then we have to wait probably until we get older. But let us welcome Sister Fazia as she make her presentation.
I greet you all with Islamic words of peace. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. It simply means may the peace and blessings of God Almighty be upon you all. I was endowed with the task to present on the benefits of hijab. So please listen with reason to the explanation of the advantages and the wisdom of wearing hijab. Those who are open to reason get the guidance and better their lives. But those who have eyes but can't see and ears but can't hear will wander in the wilderness of life forever. No amount of logical reasoning will help them. However, our job as Muslims, that is those who surrender to the will of God Almighty, is only to convey the message to the darkest corners of the world. Our job as Muslims is not to impose anything on disbelievers, because as God Almighty says in the Holy Quran, for you is your religion and for them is theirs. May God Almighty give guidance to all of us and enable us to follow Islam, which is the manual of human life. May God Almighty grant us the wisdom to understand Islam and to live our lives to its fullest by following its teachings. May God Almighty make us realize that education is not only about getting a piece of paper called a degree, but education is about learning and understanding life, the world, and the etiquette of living. May God Almighty enable us to find solutions to all the problems we encounter in life in His great message, the message of Islam. O God Almighty, enable all human beings to know the message of Islam, so this world will become a cradle of peace and stability, and so that the forces of darkness will be defeated from the face of the earth. May God Almighty be our guide in this journey of life. Amen. Hijab is popularly known as kimar, but what society refers to as hijab or kimar is more than just the head covering in Islam. According to Professor H.L.A. Hart, a definition enhances our awareness of words and sharpens our perception or understanding of them. The Quran, which is the Muslim's holy scripture, or clearly enjoins Muslim men and women to dress and behave modestly. Muslim women are specifically instructed to cover their heads when in the presence of potentially marriageable men. Surah Al-Nur, chapter 34, verse 31, in the Quran states, they, meaning the believing women, should draw their head coverings over their bosoms. A similar verse can be seen in the Old Testament. We read about what Rebecca did before Isaac in the following passage. When Rebecca raised her eyes, she caught sight of Isaac, and she swung herself down from off the camel. Then she said to the servant, who is that walking in the field to meet us? And the servant said, it is my master. And she proceeded to take a head cloth and to cover herself. Genesis chapter 24, verses 6 to 4 and 6 to 5. In the New Testament, we also read, but every woman that prays or prophesies with her head uncovered shames her head, for it is one and the same as if she were a woman with a shaved head. For if a woman does not cover herself, let her also be shorn. But if it is disgraceful for a woman to be shorn or shaved, let her be covered. Corinthians 1, chapter 11, verses 5 and 6. From the above, it is obvious that the Bible regards the veiling of women as a pious act. But the present-day commentators of the Bible, in their efforts to prove that its teachings do not in any way deprive women of their freedom, have denied this fact because they thought that it is a burden on women. Similarly, even some of the modern-day Muslims have followed the same course for the same reason, and they have tried to prove that even Islam does not put this restriction on Muslim women. But they were not successful because, unlike the Bible, the text of the Quran is preserved in its original form, and hence it is impossible to get away by twisting the meanings of its verses. Yet, this reveals that the lack of the proper knowledge of the wisdom behind the Islamic veil prevails even among the Muslims. Surah Al-Azab, chapter 33, verse 59 states, O Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, tell thy wives and daughters and the believing women that they should put on their outer garments. That is most convenient in order that they may be recognized as Muslims and not be molested. God Almighty has blessed us with the message of Islam, which simply means peace and security, and told us strategies to spread the message, which only benefits us and not God Almighty. God Almighty is beyond all needs. God Almighty says in the Quran that if the whole world gets united against a Muslim and want to harm him, they won't, except if God Almighty wills. And if the whole world unites to benefit a Muslim, it won't, except for God Almighty wills. Therefore, security comes from God Almighty. God Almighty is the protector of believers. One should never fear anyone but God Almighty. And then all of his or her fears will be erased from the heart. Those who bow before God Almighty bow to no one in the world. No one. Both of the above Quranic references and the references from both the Old and the New Testament instruct women to cover herself with a large loose overcoat and full head covering, so that no provocative part of her body will be visible. Her modest appearance would make it clear to everyone that she is a virtuous, believing woman, and no one is to molest her or sexually exploit her. This is an effective solution to the problem of sexual and street harassment that is being emphasized a lot lately by non-governmental organizations, because a Muslim woman's modest appearance is a social statement that she is not to be messed with. The benefits of hijab for women. For Muslim women, covering the head is not the sign of degradation or oppression. Why is it okay for a nun to be covered from head to toe, and that means that she's devoted to God Almighty? But when a Muslim woman does the same, it means that she's oppressed. It is a commandment from God Almighty, who is not male or female, and thus would not discriminate against women, a segment of his creation. The head covering is rather a sign of purity and dignity. It highlights the Muslim woman as a pure, virtuous woman and sets her apart from the immoral behavior associated with women who dress immodestly. The hijab is a sort of screen between the virtuous Muslim woman and the evil that exists in the world. When a woman wears a hijab, she is less likely to be harassed by men, with lusty motives. She is less likely to be exploited for her beauty and femininity. The hijab allows a woman to move about outside the confines of her home with her attention on the task she has set out to do. The Muslim woman does not try to impress anyone but God Almighty when outside of her home. She is not concerned if men find her attractive or if people are impressed because she has the latest fashions or the newest hairstyle. She leaves her home as a self-confident part of the human race, not as a fashion plate seeking stares and adoration in order to gain self-esteem. The hijab cuts down on competition among women. How many people in the West sacrifice financial savings and health in order to have plastic surgery in a desperate attempt to meet up to an unrealistic standard of beauty? In Islam, women are appreciated for their knowledge, piety, and contribution to society. When women wear hijab, one finds that the most beautiful women are not necessarily the most popular. Rather, a woman is assessed for her mind and not just superficial physical traits. The following incident took place when Muhammad Ali's daughter arrived at his home wearing clothing that were not modest. Here is the story as told by one of his daughters. When we finally arrived, the chauffeur escorted my younger sister Layla and me up to my father's suite. As usual, he was hiding behind the door waiting to scare us. We exchanged many hugs and kisses as we could possibly give in one day. My father took a good look at us. Then he sat me down on his lap and said something that I will never forget. He looked me straight in the eyes and said, "Hannah, everything that God made valuable in this world is hard to get to. Where do you find diamonds? Deep down in the ground, covered and protected. Where do you find pearls? Deep down at the bottom of the ocean, covered up and protected in a beautiful shell. Where do you find gold? Gold. Way deep down in the mine, covered over with layers and layers of rocks. You've got to work hard to get them." He looks at me with serious eyes. "Your body is sacred. You're far more precious than diamonds and pearls, and you should be covered too." This was taken from the book, More Than a Hero, Muhammad Ali's Life Lessons Through His Daughter's Eyes. My final words are, may the peace and blessings of God Almighty be upon us all.
Thank you very much, Sister Fazia. And I believe also, because I'm glad that you said the story with Muhammad Ali, because one of the things that we find when you go into the jewelry stores and all of them, the prized possessions are always hidden at the back. They bring them out if you ask, you know, but they have the others in front. But the prized ones, they're always hidden. And I think one of the things that we have to learn as individuals, and more so as women, is that we have to have that self-confidence. Because we believe that when we walk out there and, how are you doing, you know, the way the men speak to us, and that is what a man is looking for. That is not what a man is looking for. But that is what society has now taught us. And so we sell ourselves short every day. And now I'm encouraging us that, you know, we should. And I really appreciate, I would like to have a copy of your presentation so that we can also use that. And I know for some of us, and we would understand here today, as I said earlier, for some of us, we don't have that authority right now to make certain decisions over our lives. But we hope that in the future, and that we could ensure that our children do the right thing. Moving on, and we're going to have another spoken word, and we're going to welcome the Joseph sisters, Sister Sakina and Sister Lindisha. Okay, Sister Lindisha is going to do this one.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
This other spoken word is entitled, He is Allah. He is the one
the first, the last, the supreme. The especially merciful are Rahim, the pure and holy, he is so kind. Keep in mind Al-Latif, he heals your pain, he's As-Salam, the perfect peace. We turn to him in joy and grief. Only he can grant relief. He is the answerer, Al-Mujib, the owner of lordship, the only king, the owner of worship, so worship him. He has no partner, so no child. He is the greatest, so no. While you listen, he hears clearer. And what you see, he sees clearer. Closer than your vein, or even nearer. Not contained or constrained by his creation. Above his throne in a majestic manner befitting his majesty. Beyond comprehension, need to mention. He's the only one that can relieve tension. In his mention, the hearts find rest. The most loving, no less than perfection. He never rested, never slept. Most magnificent, I suggest. You confess to none but he, for to associate partners is the gravest sin. And his punishment is severe to return to him. So return to him. He's the forgiver if you turn and repent. He is forgiving perpetually. The most powerful protecting provider, fair decider, the just judge. The sole legislator, witness, he's the witness. The most forbearing, for him, hearts flutter and tongues stutter. Heads bow in prostration and tears stream. Lord of all nations and creation, the most appreciative, the most high. The Almighty, the best sight to see, but never can be truly encompassed by creation. The most beautiful, the most wise. He is the truth, so no lies. Not born, nor is any born from he. No power, but he, when he wants something, just says, be, and it is. He is ever living, self-sustaining, all aware, all knowing, so supreme. The rich, the able, the eternal, in all which rely, the best protecting friend for you and I. He is the guide, he fashioned mankind, guided the blind and gave you life. He is the generous, so isn't it time? Our hearts softened and surrendered to the Lord of all splendor, and we listened and obeyed. And I am just a poor slave, so save the praise for the one that made. He is Allah.
Awesome.
Thank you very much, Lindisha. Okay, as we know also, today we're celebrating Emancipation, and I'm going to read a piece for us today, and it's called The Apology. They beat me, and I called you to save me, but you couldn't. So I secretly resented you. They took our babies and sold them. I begged you to save us, but you couldn't. So I secretly blamed you. They raped me, and I cried out for you to protect me, but you couldn't, so I stopped trusting you. You were supposed to be my man, my provider, my protector, but when I needed you, you couldn't be there. So I hated you. How could I let you tell me what to do, when Massa could protect me more than you? How could I submit to you when you are forced to submit to Massa? So to protect myself, I submitted to the one who could protect me and our children. I stopped trusting you. I stopped loving you. I stopped honoring you. I stopped valuing you, and in turn, I became valueless to you. I didn't see the frustration in your eyes when our children were sold. I didn't hear your silent cries when I was beaten. I didn't see your anger when I was being ravished. I didn't understand that you held your emotions to be strong for me. I thought you didn't care, but you wanted to be there. You wanted to protect me, but Masa made it so you couldn't. So I would trust him more than you. I didn't see the hidden hands shaping our destiny. All I saw was my pain and the feeling that you neglected me. For all the times I blamed you, I'm sorry. For the resentment and distrust I've held against you for centuries, I'm sorry. For the times I've let you down, for all the times I've broken your spirit with my words and my actions, for the times I openly rejected you and tried to control you, because I thought less of you, I'm sorry. Masa had a plan that he said would work for 400 years. 400 years is over now. My eyes are wide open. I see the king in you. Please forgive my word, my wrongs, and see your queen in me. Thank you very much. That poem, The Apology, it really speaks to the way we as women were treated in slavery. And so that was the plan of the white man, the plan to take our husbands, our fathers, our men away from us. And we saw them as not being able to protect us, as not being there. But they would have kept their emotions inside. And so today we thank God because our eyes are now wide open and we can see the king in our men and they can see the queen in us. A spoken word, and this another spoken word. This is going to be done by Sister Fazia. I want to say this to us: we rate ability in men by what they finish, not what they attempt. We rate ability in men by what they finish, not what they attempt. So I just want, I'm going to leave a few with us this afternoon, and one more before Sister Fazia comes. It's difficult to inspire others to accomplish what you've not been willing to try. It is difficult to inspire others to accomplish what you haven't been willing to try. Let's welcome to Safazi as she comes.
This Is Not My Islam by Sanasino, a spoken word poem speaking out against the hijacking and tarnishing of the name of Islam by extremist militants such as ISIS and others. See, too many layman preachers are teaching our angry youths all about how to hate and divide rather than love and unite. They come with a message written in blood. Their call is arrogant and their approach is rough. They project majesty on a pulpit, but they don't know much. And yet, we lend our ears, we send our guns, and we give our tears. We turn a blind eye to the genocide. They live with pride as we live in fear. Of what? It is becoming quite sad that we would rather keep shutum when we've been told to forbid all bad from wherever it may come. See, my crusade is against those who manipulate the message, split my people in half and misguide the masses, support criminals and justify it with a random passage clause. What's knowledge to parrots and what's humanity to humans with inhumane intentions? They shout voices of war, but voices of peace aren't mentioned. And we are quick to question our own logic. And we are quick to question our own emotions and hearts. But the words of the Sheikh, no, they can't be questioned. The people are busy fighting a cause and you come with your ignorance and create widespread war. Your misinformed tweet is causing outright war. You're exposing group X and exposing group Y, Facebook-like pages causing outright war. How can you sit there and tell me to kill believers and expect me to take heed of your call? Are you my prophet? Are you gifted with divine guidance? These kids think they can fail their school life and redeem themselves by growing a beard and inciting violence. Why is it my duty to fight your wars When your sons are protected when they leave your doors, is jihad only jihad for those beneath your feet? Sorry, but I too have been blessed with logic indeed. No man is immune from criticism, it's evident. And the length of your beard is no measurement of your piety. We are equals in this society. If my blood is cheap, then your blood is cheap. When you spew hate speech, then we'll respond with love speech. Cause that is a message I've learned and hope to teach my seed for thousands of years. For thousands of years, our coexistence has been sacred. Now you want to pop up with your made-up hatred? Isn't that innovation? Did God send you revelation? Did the prophet tell you his message needs reform or renovation? Did the whole world misinterpret Islam? Did he mean genocide when he said salam? Did he mean peace? Did he mean kill when he said do no harm? I don't recall him ever saying ransack, pillage, and murder those of Al-Kitab. Christians, Jews, and other sects believe in the Lord. You must think twice before you slice more pieces with your sword, cause we've stopped creating life to build more coffins. I suggest you kids just write your own book and elect your own prophet, cause this rubbish you preach is not my Islam. This hate you preach is not my Islam. This barbarism you speak is not my Islam. This message you tweet is not my Islam. See, my religion orders me to receive and return peace. Assalamu alaikum. Wa alaikum salam.
Beautiful. Again, here we are today. And if we see and we know what is going on, and you know, we talk about persons luring young people from all across the world to join ISIS and to kill, then what are we doing wrong? Why aren't we getting young people to come and say, or to come and join Islam, or for those of us who are here as Christians, because we have some of us in our midst, what are we not doing? Why is it easier for a man with a gun to get thousands of young people by just sending a message, whether it's Facebook or whatever, to believe what they're saying is right? Then we are not doing something right. What are we not doing? And this is something that we need to check, because we should have had here packed today. Something is wrong, my brothers and sisters. Something is wrong.